Jesus was born in an obscure village. He was born to a peasant woman. He never went to college. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. 2,000 years have come and gone, and today Jesus is the central figure of the human race. All the armies that have ever marched, all the navies that have ever sailed, all the parliaments that have ever sat, all the kings that have ever reigned, all put together have not affected the life of mankind on earth as powerfully as this one solitary life. In a world where it is said that there are many roads to God, Jesus stands alone. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." Join us January 1st to the 22nd for a four-part sermon series entitled, "The Case for the Christian Faith." The first one we dealt with is the exclusivity of Christianity, the belief that Jesus is the only way. We looked at that January 1st. Then the second week, we looked at how can a good God, a loving God, send people to hell? A difficult question. And we dealt with that last week. And if you've missed these, go back and have a chance to look at them. Today, we are dealing with this thought. How can a good God allow suffering? Why is there so much suffering on the earth? Our minds, if they roll back to January 2010, the earthquake that took place in Haiti, 220,000 people killed, 300,000 people injured. Folks, that's 500,000 people killed or injured, another 1.5 million people without homes. Why is there so much suffering on this planet? For minds roll back to 2004, the tsunami that took place in the Indian Ocean. 250,000 people, 250,000 people killed that day. One reporter said this, if God is God, he is not good. And if God is good, he is not God. You cannot have it both ways after the Indian Ocean catastrophe. Why does God allow all the pain in this world? Why all the sickness? Why death? Why the heartbreak? Why wars? Why abuse? The argument says this: if God were all-powerful, he could stop suffering. If God were all-loving, he would stop suffering. The fact that suffering exists means that God, the God of the Christian faith, cannot exist. That is an argument against Christianity. But I want to say this is more than an argument of philosophy. It's an argument of the heart. If you haven't come across people with this going on inside of them, you've not talked to enough people. Individuals, I know one guy I was witnessing to, and he said, "What about my grandmother? She was a godly woman, and she died with cancer and suffered when she died. Where was God then?" Folks, it's a true question. It's not just philosophy. This is a question of the heart. When individuals go through loss, a loss of a loved one, a time of mourning, oftentimes part of that mourning, in fact, a natural part of the process of that mourning is saying, "Why?" And the question goes back to the ultimate, "Why, God, did you allow this?" I would imagine many of us that are here today have asked that question. If you've gone through much in life, that has rolled through your head, but you've dealt with people that are struggling with this. Where is the answer? What is the answer for suffering? If you're a Hindu, you would say suffering is a result of your past sins in your previous lives. Because they see as a circle, a big circle, you go around and around and around and around and around. And if you do something bad in this life, then you'll suffer in the next life. So they would say, if you're suffering in this life, it's because of the evil of your past lives. Therefore, if you're suffering in this life, I should not help you. One of the reasons that my sister and her husband went to India right after the tsunami was because the belief in India of those ones that were left as orphans after the tsunami should not be cared for, because that was the sin of their past life. That's the reason they're orphans. That's the reason they should be beggars or turned into little prostitutes. It's because of their sin of the past life. I don't think that is an acceptable answer to suffering. Buddhism. Buddhism says it's all an illusion. Islam says, well, it's the will of Allah. Atheism. I want to just pause for a few moments on this subject. Atheists, how do they deal with suffering? The atheist belief offers zero hope in suffering. Their complaint that if God is good, he would stop suffering. But what do they offer in exchange? They offer zero. They offer nothing. They offer hopelessness. In fact, listen to one of their writers, Richard Dawkins. Richard Dawkins says this. Follow along with me. He says, some people are going to get hurt. Other people are going to get lucky. You won't find any rhyme or reason in it, nor any justice. The universe that we observe has precisely the properties we should expect. If there is at bottom no design, no purpose, no evil, no good, nothing but pitiless indifference. Folks, that is a mouthful of hope, isn't it? That the world is just as we expected. At the bottom, if there is no design, no God, no purpose, that you have no purpose in existence, if there's no good or no evil, because if there's no God, there is no moral standard. There is no right nor wrong. Who can set a moral standard if there's no God? Can society? Society doesn't even have the right to tell us what is right and what is wrong. There is no morals. All there is pitiless indifference. Folks, that almost wanted to take Prozac, wouldn't it? That's depressing. That's bad. Pass me the Valium. I'm going to go to the next point. It's nasty. That's their picture. That's the hope they offer during suffering. They say that humanity, even though it's evil, it's okay, because that's just survival of the fittest. That's what it boils down to. I don't like that thought. If we were to go to Auschwitz today and go to Block 5, Block 4, Room 5, I didn't put the picture up of this because it was so disturbing, I didn't want to show you. But in Block 4, Room 5, is the hair of 140,000 women whose heads were shaved just before they went to be gassed, murdered, and incinerated. 140,000 heads of hair. Viktor Frankl was a Jewish psychiatrist who spent time as a prisoner in Auschwitz. During the Holocaust, he lost his wife and his entire family. He was the only one left, except for one sister, that got away from Germany and went to Australia. Viktor Frankl says this: the gas chambers of Auschwitz were the ultimate consequence of a theory that man is nothing but the product of heredity and environment, or as the Nazis like to say, blood and soil. I'm absolutely convinced that the gas chambers of Auschwitz were ultimately prepared not in some ministry or other in Berlin, but rather at the desks and lecture halls of nihilistic scientists and philosophers. I mean, just nihilistic. The word nihilistic means those who reject religion and moral principles and believe that life is meaningless. The doctrine of atheism, the doctrine of Richard Dawkins. He says this again: I am absolutely convinced that the gas chambers of Auschwitz were ultimately prepared not in some ministry or other in Berlin, but rather at the desks and lecture halls of nihilistic, atheistic scientists and philosophers. What hope does atheism provide in suffering? None. Nothing but the survival of the fittest. Not right nor wrong, not good, not evil. And that suffering is just going to happen no matter what. Can I say, if there is no God, there is no hope? It is simple as that. In suffering, if there is no God, there is no hope. But there is a God, and there is hope. I want to tell you today, there is a God, and there is hope, and there is purpose and meaning in this life. There is good and evil in this life. There is hope simply because there is God. Is there really a design and a designer in life? Rabbi Zacharias says this: where there is freedom, there is a possibility of love. Where there is love, there is a possibility of pain. Where there is pain, there is a possibility of a savior. And where there is a savior, there's a possibility of restoration. Folks, that is the blueprint of what we see in this whole world. Where there is freedom, God created us with a free will. We can say yes and no to one another. We can say yes and no to God. Isn't that true? We are created with a free will. Why did God create us with a free will? So that we could freely love Him. We could choose to love Him. We could choose to follow Him. He gave us a free will so we could freely choose that possibility of love. And where there's the possibility of free choice and love, there's also a possibility of pain. How many found a little pain in love? The pain of rejection of love. Pain not just for us, but for God. One of the great pains of this life is the rejection of love. Those who have gone through the pain of divorce know that that rejection is severe and life-changing. And yet God has experienced that over and over again when people reject His love. Freedom, love, pain leaves us with a possibility of a Savior. If God is a good God, He would not only give us freedom, it also give us a Savior. And that Savior is none other than Jesus Christ. And where there is a Savior, there's the opportunity of the restoration and the healing of all things within our lives. Three things I want to talk about today in suffering. Three ways that we can face suffering. You can open your Bibles to Peter, 1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to read starting with verse 3 down to verse 8. We're going to look back to something, we're going to look ahead to something, and then we're going to look inward at something. We're going to look three different directions today. We're going to look backwards, we're going to look ahead, then we're going to look inward. 1 Peter chapter 3, starting at verse 1, it says this: Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He's given us new birth into a living hope, hallelujah, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Folks, we are given new hope through the resurrection. It's a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power till the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last times. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus is revealed. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And even though you do not see Him now, you believe in Him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. Peter is writing to the church in persecution. These people knew what it was to suffer. They knew what it was to lose homes, and some of them even to lose loved ones because they were Christians. They went through suffering. We may not be going through the suffering as they are, but we also go through times of suffering. In times of suffering, sometimes people give up on God. Sometimes they get angry at God. Sometimes they blame God. But my word for you today is don't give up on God, even though you don't understand, because you'll find no hope outside of God. You will find no hope outside of God. If you throw away God, you throw away hope. First of all, we need to look back at who suffered before us. Verse 6 and 7 says this: In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. Verse 7, he talks about your faith being like gold that was refined in the fire, and even though it's refined, the fire still perishes, but the thought of going into the furnace of refinement, that we have to go through times of refinement, of fiery trials. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12, he picks up this thought again. He says, Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal. Some translations call it the fiery trial that's come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. The fiery trials of life. The fiery furnaces of life that come to test and prove our faith. We've all faced them, haven't we? Difficult times, times of loss, times of bereavement, times of pain, times of sickness. But we're not the first ones to go through fiery trials. When Peter is writing this, I wonder if he was thinking back to a story in the book of Daniel where three Hebrew boys were asked to bow down to a statue that was made by old King Nebuchadnezzar, and they refused. And so they took them and they heated the fiery furnace up seven times hotter than it had ever been heated before. And they go to throw these three boys into the furnace, and those who brought them were consumed by the fire of the furnace themselves. The guards perished, and the boys were thrown alive and bound into that furnace. By and by, the king looked in.
And he said, didn't we throw three men bound into that fire? He says, why do I look down and I'm counting four and they're not bound any longer? And the fourth one looks like the son of the gods. And he said, bring those boys out, set them free, and declare that their God, the God of the fiery furnace, should not be rejected, but be worshipped by all people. The God of the fiery furnace. Folks, you go through fiery trials, we serve the God of the fiery furnace of trials. Folks, there's hope in the midst of our fiery furnace because God walks with us in the midst of our fiery trials. Listen to what the word says. In Isaiah chapter 43, I love this passage. It says, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fires, the fiery trials, the fiery furnaces of life, it says this, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. God is the one that's with us in the fiery trials of life. We need to look back and realize we're not the first ones to have fiery trials, but we'll see that God is with people in the midst of their furnace. God's with others who've suffered. We need to also look back at Jesus Christ who suffered before us. One of the powerful passages during his time of suffering is Matthew chapter 27, verse 46. Jesus here gives what is considered to be the deepest cry of humanity. And he's hanging upon the cross, says this, and 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? Much has been said about this. Let me say this. The pain on the cross, we talked about it 2 weeks ago. The pain of the cross was terrific. They scourged him. They whipped him with that cat of nine tails, with that whip that was leather strands, and each of those strands was a sharp shred of bone or a chunk of lead, and it was designed to cut through the flesh and rip it off your body. And Jesus Christ was whipped until his back was like a plowed field and his bowels came out. And that was the beginning. They took him before a group of men and they took turns hitting him in the face and said, prophesy, who has hit you? They planted a crown of thorns into his scalp. And then they nailed him to a cross. And they hung him there to suffer and to die. Folks, that's not the only pain of the cross. In fact, that's not the worst pain of the cross. Understand that Jesus was God. He was not created. He was the creator of all things. He was eternally in existence with the Father. His relationship with the Father was from the beginning. In the beginning, God. In the beginning, God created. Therefore, God and the Father and the Son were in total existence with the Holy Spirit from the beginning. The eternal relationship of the triune God upon the cross had to be broken for a time. And the pain of the breaking of that eternal relationship was powerful. Jesus Christ not only took upon himself the suffering for our sins, but he took upon himself our separation from God. Get this. Every one of us, because of our sins, we're separated from God. God cannot join himself with sin because God is holy. What room would God have in heaven for sin? And that sin separates us from God, that God cannot look on us. He can't deal with us. We're separated from God. But on the cross, Jesus became sin for us. He took upon himself our sins. And that moment he took upon himself our sins, he also took our separation from God. And at that moment, the relationship between the eternal relationship between the triune God, the Father and the Son, was separated. And Jesus, my God, he had not rejected his Father. My God. And he felt the full rejection of sin. He felt the deepest pain of all humanity. And his cry was the cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? The cry that many people cry out in sickness and death. My God, why have you forsaken me? For 3 days he suffered with this. He died, was buried, and 3 days he spent in that tomb. His body was there, but his spirit went to the greatest fiery furnace of them all. It descended to hell. And there the scripture says he led captivity captive. He descended to hell to set people free. 3 days later, he rose. And as he rose from the dead, Mary finds him in the tomb, and he says to Mary, don't touch me, and I haven't yet ascended to my Father. Hold on a second. Don't hold me here. I'm going back, and I need to get that relationship back with the Father again. I've done what he's asked me to do. Now I'm going to go back, and I'm looking for a hug from my Father. And he ascended to heaven, and that relationship was brought back together again. Folks, that's the price that was paid for our salvation. We need to look back at the suffering of Jesus Christ. Jesus suffered for us. Christianity is the only religion that claims that God became fully human and therefore knows human suffering firsthand, and no one knows suffering like our suffering Savior. He knows it firsthand. He knows what it is to be rejected. He knows what it is to be born in poverty. He knows what it was to be imprisoned and tortured. He knows what it was to be rejected and put to death. He knows what it is to be separated. What is the answer to suffering? I can tell you this. I can tell you one thing. The answer of suffering is not this. It is not that God doesn't care. God cares. Jesus loves us, and he suffered for us. Those who still question what is suffering, it is not, I can guarantee you, it is not that God doesn't care. For everything that you go through, he is touched by every feeling that you have. He is moved by the feelings of your infirmities. First of all, we look back. Second of all, we need to look forward. We look back to see who suffered before us. We look forward because there is a great hope. Peter, again,
First Peter chapter 1, it says, praise be to God. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. We have a living hope. Can I tell you that the God of atheism is a dead hope? There is hopelessness. There is no hope except for the survival of the fittest. Evil against evil. Whoever wants to die first, kill or be killed. There is no hope. But in Christianity, we have a living hope. Why? Because Jesus Christ is raised from the dead. Because Jesus lives, we will live also. We have a living hope. It's not just a spiritual hope either. It's not just a apple pie and the sweet by and by. Folks, there's more than that. It's not just a spiritual hope. It's also a physical hope. Listen to what the scripture says. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says this. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. But we will all be changed in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. And we will be changed. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up by victory. I believe that Jesus Christ is coming back, and he's coming back to change this old physical world. The book of Revelation is not just about us going to heaven. How many knew that? It's not just about us going to heaven and getting a harp and getting a crown and getting a little cloud to set on and play away. It's not about a heavenly jam session. The book of Revelation is about, you look at the ending, it's about Jesus Christ coming back to this earth, and he's going to shake things up. He's going to straighten out this mess. It's about Jesus Christ coming back physically to this physical earth and changing it, and suffering will end, and death will be over, and tears will be wiped away. He's going to fix this old mess. Folks, we have hope in Jesus Christ. It's not found in the books of atheism. It's found in Jesus Christ. That's the only source of hope in times of suffering. Nobody else offers an ounce. It's found in Jesus Christ. Folks, we've got this thing nailed down. If you want hope, you need Jesus Christ. You don't find it anywhere else. Folks, we could put that on our church and nail it up. You want hope? Come in here. You won't find it with the Buddhists or Islam or Hinduism or being an atheist. You'll find it in Jesus Christ. There's hope even in suffering. There's hope because we have a God that suffered with us. We have hope because there's a God that's going to come back someday and fix this old mess. This old messed up planet is going to be changed. And suffering will be ended. Hallelujah. Greek Stoic philosophers, they believed that the earth was in endless cycles. They believed that the earth would go on so long, and at some point, the earth would wind down, burn, and then be reborn again, start again. The phrase for this they used to describe this was Pelagenesia. That's a Greek word. Pelagenesia. Peleg means again. Genesia means birth. That the earth would burn up and then be born again. Matthew chapter 19, verse 28, it says this. Jesus said to them, truly, I tell you, at the renewal of all things when the Son of Man sits on his throne. You have followed me, will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Truly, I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man sits on his throne, at the renewal of all things, can you guess what the Greek word is? Palingenesis. He pulls a word out of the Greek Stoic philosophy. And he says, this thing is winding down, and I'm going to restart this earth. Folks, not just us are born again, but when Jesus comes back to this earth is going to be born again. We're going to have a new heaven. We're going to have a new earth. Jesus is going to come back with such power, with such might. When he comes to this planet is going to be changed. It's going to be reborn, and the darkness and the decay and the sickness and the pain and the suffering will be over when Jesus Christ comes back. He starts it all over again. And the lion will lay down with the lamb. And his presence will cover the earth like the waters cover the sea. And peace will reign forevermore when Jesus Christ comes back. When he comes back, he will change things. Jesus is coming back to this old rebellious planet, and this planet will be changed. Hallelujah. You want an answer for the situation of hope? Look backwards. Look back to the suffering of Jesus. Look forward to his return. C.S. Lewis said this. They say of some temporal suffering, no future bliss can make up for it. But knowing that the heaven, knowing that heaven once attained, not knowing that heaven once attained will work backward to turn even that agony into glory. Folks, when Jesus Christ comes back, the worst things of life will be turned around. The suffering of life will be revealed as the furnace that produced the greatest gold and the greatest purity, the greatest strength in our lives. Look back at suffering. Look ahead at our hope. And thirdly, we need to look into our heart and see that suffering produces faith. 1 Peter 1, verse 7. I want to read verse 7 from the New Living Translation, and I really like the New Living Translation. It's actually a better translation than the NIV, which is the most popular version. Look what it says. These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise, glory, and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. There's a Japanese art called kintsugi. And kintsugi is the method of repairing vessels. Through my PowerPoint, I've shown you a number of them. Vessels that have been repaired by this method. It's the belief of the Japanese that a vessel is worth more than the clay or that is made from. One of the things that makes a vessel valuable is its history. And when a precious vessel is broken, it is not discarded. But those of great value that have been broken, they are taken to the experts in this art akin to see. And they will mix together resin and gold. And with resin and gold, they will put the vessel back together again. And the final state of it, because its value is in its history, it's actually gained value because of its brokenness. And the final state of that vessel has more value than the previous state of that vessel, no matter what it's worth, because it's been broken and healed with gold. Yes, we have been broken. Yes, we have suffered. Some of us can look back into our childhood and talk about evils that were done to us. Some can look through their teenage years, and there's been woundedness that you've brought through that. Well, and through your adult life, points of pain, hurt, rejection, suffering. The trials of your faith. And yet, when it's touched by the Master's hand, when those hurts have been allowed to be healed by the Master's hand, the end result is you come out so much more beautiful, so much more precious, having so much more history and meaning in your life, because you've looked back at the cross, you look forward into your hope, and you've experienced the healing of God. I don't have it in my notes, but verse 12, if you have your Bibles open. Verse 12, the end of verse 12, it says that the angels look at this process of, with amazement at this process of redemption. The angels are always looking at this. It's interesting that the angels, the word that is used for looking at the story of the gospel is actually lusting. That they look with intent. They look with something that's curiosity. They look with intention at it. And they just, it's beyond their understanding. It's beyond what they can, it's just so huge to them that they just want to study it all the time. The story of how God so loved that he took upon himself our own separation from God. Gave us freedom so that we could have love. He gave us love knowing that we'd have pain. He gave us pain knowing that we would get a Savior. And he sent us a Savior knowing that in the end he will restore all things. They look at it with amazement. Look at the last part of this verse, verse 7. We read it earlier. It says this, so when your faith remain strong through many trials. It will bring, look at this, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. I want us to read this again and look at this word. It will bring who? Is there a verse up there? Who? Yes, we will bring God honor, but when people look at us, it will bring you honor. It'll bring praise and glory and honor. When they see, when the angels see us, they will break out in praise. They will look at us and they will be amazed. They'll look at these broken vessels that have been healed by the gold that's been tried in the fire, and they will be amazed and they will give glory to God, and they'll reach down and take our hands. I can just see, congratulations. It's amazing what God has done in your life. And we'll just simply say all praise to Him, because it's God who's with us in our fiery furnace. We serve the God of the fiery furnace. That's who our God is. Aaron, you can bring your team back. Is there an answer during suffering? Can I tell you, yes, there's an answer during suffering. And there's only one group that has a good answer. And our answer is this: there is hope. God loves us, and we know that because God suffered for us. There is hope because Jesus died for us. There is hope because Jesus Christ is coming back. There is hope because God is healing us even today. Stand with me.